Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 21st meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, could I remind all members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is a decision on taking item 4 in private. Are we agreed? Thank you, we're agreed. Our second item of business this morning is an evidence session on the Hunting with Dogs Scotland Bill, and I welcome to the meeting our panel who will focus on prosecution and policing perspectives. And we have Michael Clancy, OBE, Director of Law Reform, the Law Society of Scotland, William Telford, the Detective Sergeant from Police Scotland, Sarah Shaw, Principal Procurator Fiscal Depute Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Services, and Robbie Kernahan, Director of Green Economy from Nature Scot. We're going to take questions till around about 11 o'clock, and I'll kick off this morning. We've heard from witnesses the difficulties they've experienced or perceived around investigating and prosecuting alleged offences under the 2002 Act, and whether the amended offences in Section 1 or in Section 1 and 2 will provide greater clarity and ease if these sections are included in the bill. Can you give us your overview of whether it's going to make things clearer and easy to enforce? And I'll kick off with William and then Sarah.
Hey, good morning. Yeah, I think there certainly is an improvement on the current legislation, the Protection of Wild Mammals Act. A big thing for us, though, is the terminology, and we think there's probably still an opportunity to amend the terminology in the bill to make offences easier to enforce. So, deliberate's been removed from this this bill, so that's welcome, because I think that did confuse matters. However, what is a fairly standard excuse, for example, for hair coursing, is the offenders will claim they'd just let their dog off for exercise or to do the toilet, and it's just chased the hair off its own free will out with their control. And we can find that difficult to disprove that. So where Police Scotland think there might be a benefit is the inclusion of the term willfully, oblique, intentionally, or recklessly allowed their dog to do this, to sort of negate against those excuses.
Okay, Sarah.
Good morning. As William has already mentioned, the bill certainly seeks to clarify the concerns previously expressed around the language in the current legislation, as embodied in Lord Bonamy's report and expressed by other organisations. There seems to be greater clarity of language and importantly, a consistency in the expressions used in the bill. So, overall, it does appear to be an improved position in the current bill. And obviously, there are certain, as already been mentioned, the word deliberately has been removed, which perhaps adds some clarity to the offence now under, well, in the bill under Section 1. And obviously, there's additional matters like a definition being given to cover, the definition of cover. I note that some of the definitions remain the same and some terms are not defined, such as to search for, stalk and to flush from cover. I assume that's because it was considered that it wasn't necessary to define those terms.
Thank you. And Michael Clancy, one of the reasons we've heard for bringing this bill forward is to close loopholes. Do you think it goes far enough?
Good morning, convener. Good morning, everyone. That's an interesting question, and the proof, of course, will be in the eating of this pudding. Closing loopholes, of course, it depends what you mean by a loophole. That might be a one person's perspective of a perfectly respectable defence I think we were concerned in terms of changing the definition about the use of the phrase "using a dog," and as you'll see from section 1.4, just let me find the bill on my screen. Section 1.4 tells us about a person using a dog when the hunting of a wild animal by that person involves the use of a dog, even if the dog is not under the person's control or direction. If there is a question about who is responsible for the use of the dog, and I'm not even entirely sure that one is using a dog when hunting, and I reflect on the term in the 2002 Act, which was hunting with a dog. There are issues there about what this actually means, and then, of course, when the dog is not under that person's control or direction, one might say that it would be an easy defence to raise that I wasn't in control of the dog when it took off and, as we've heard earlier, chased a hare. That might be a perfectly feasible defence, but some others might think of that as being a loophole.
Okay, Rachel Hamilton's got a supplementary.
Just a point that Mr Telford made there about some of the changes within the bill in terms of deliberate. Now, how would you envisage that, because Lord Bonamy said last week that the bill is clear and simple and we should avoid unduly complicating it. I'm just wondering how changing the word or extending the potential scope in the bill would actually then affect ordinary dog walkers.
Yeah. So I think there is a differentiation could be factored in for those people who are hare coursing and those average dog walkers who are taking reasonable steps to keep their dogs under control. So I suppose that's where we'd have to, if there was the inclusion of reckless, we would have to define that. So, for example, hare coursers will typically set themselves up in a way to find a hare. So they will, for example, line up along a field with the dogs and then walk the dogs until they find it. So the hare essentially has nowhere to go. It's flushed out, essentially. So that could be factored in. That's something, an average dog walker's not going to do. So I would say that act in itself is reckless. So we may not be able to prove that they are deliberately hare coursing, but that very act is reckless and sort of not something your average dog walker would do.
Convener, I'm quite concerned about this because I've seen hare coursers and they had scarpered before anybody got there, and that means that nobody had seen them. It was pitch black. They had torches, and that is the problem with hare coursing, is that the police cannot catch these people because they're fleet of foot. And if you're describing that scenario, that they've gone before you, even if a person was walking a dog at night, which is not necessarily going to be the case in the middle of nowhere, mm-hmm. but it's still that this bill needs to be very clear with regards to protecting ordinary dog walkers.
So can I ask, how many occasions were you and your colleagues turn up to a reported incident, a hare coursing or whatever, and have to actually stop and say, what are the chances actually of this leading to a prosecution? That because it's there's too many opportunities for the criminals to come up with an excuse. How often does that happen? And do you think the times that will happen will be reduced because the law is clearer, and when you take the case to the procurator, there's a more likely chance that will be progressed?
I think under the bill as it currently is, I think that there will be greater opportunity to get arrests and potentially convictions. The inclusion of rabbits in the definition of mammal, I think, will aid that, because to an extent that will negate against the excuse of hare coursers that they were hunting rabbits. False excuse, if that's the case. More often than not, a hair course incident that will be reported to us, and nobody will be arrested. That's not just down to problems with the current legislation. It's first and foremost, it's tracing the people involved. Quite often by the time we find them, that they've gone. So, for example, over the last month, there's been 7 suspected hair coursing incidents reported to police. 3 of those crimes have been recorded for. The other 4, we didn't have sufficient evidence to actually say that a crime was occurring. So it's one thing saying there is so many recorded crimes for hair coursing, but actually there's potentially lots and lots more incidents that we can't definitively say was a hair coursing and record it as such. But it's certainly a prevalent crime type.
Okay, Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, folks.
Morning.
I'm possibly going to have to pardon the pun takers down a rabbit hole here. Would I be right in thinking, and I certainly know from my own experience, that this is the case, that hair coursers have a particular type of dog?
Yes. Yep.
So somebody out walking a poodle is highly unlikely to be hair coursing. But somebody with a Lurcher or a Greyhound, it's far more likely that they're going to be. Does the bill need to specify a particular type of dog or types of dog that would ordinarily be used in hair coursing?
That would certainly make enforcement more straightforward for the police. I would say there is a select number of dogs that are used for it, as you say. So I think that would make it more straightforward for police to enforce.
But from a legislator's point of view, where do you draw the line? Because a collie crossed with a greyhound could make a good
Exactly, yeah. Uh-huh. Right. Okay. Yeah, there would be challenges.
Yeah. So, as I said, I've taken us down a rabbit hole there. So.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. You've covered some of these issues, but it was just in terms of some of the criticisms, Detective Sergeant, that the police had made of the old Act, 2002 Act. One of the criticisms was the number and complexity of the exceptions to the offence of deliberately hunting. I don't know if you can say any more about that, or whether the number of exceptions was itself a problem that this bill rectifies in any way.
Yeah, I think the exceptions in this bill, there's not that many of them. There's only 3, and they're pretty clear and straightforward. So I don't think there's any ambiguity with them. So yeah, I think that does that is an improvement.
And I wonder if the Law Society has a view on that, finally.
Exceptions, yeah, I think the exceptions are quite clear. Some of them replicate provisions which you see in the 22 Act. But I was just thinking to myself there at that point which Rachel Hamilton raised about innocent dog walkers. May I just say in passing that people are not criminals until they're convicted of an offence. They may be suspected criminals or alleged criminals, but they're not actually criminals until they're convicted. But let's say a dog walker whose dog runs off chasing an animal. One could imagine creating a statutory defence, as there are already in the bill statutory defences which revolve around the exceptions. And so you could have a statutory defence for a person who is walking one of those dogs which the convener has, or one of the members, sorry, has identified as not being the kind of dog which chases after hares. Not being in the situation where they are doing anything other than simply walking their own domestic dog for the purposes of exercising the animal. Generally speaking about the exceptions, I think they fit the bill. I have a point to raise on the environmental exception, if I'm allowed to proceed on that basis. You may have questions for that later. I don't want to hold up the committee at this point if this isn't appropriate,
Yeah, we're probably going to come on to that a little bit later. Alistair, do you have further questions on the fences?
No, I'm fine. The wider question of the fences, yeah. Well, some of the... moving on to the issue of rabbits, I think a number of people have raised the issue, I suppose, of the accidental use of a dog to chase, or not use of, but a dog chasing of its own volition a rabbit. So I won't perhaps pursue that one too much further, other than to ask whether people have a view on the inclusion of rabbits under the definition of wild animal, and whether people are content in that case that the bill still allows for adequate pest control. So again, if I can perhaps go to William Telford first and ask if you're content that the bill allows you to make that distinction.
Yeah, I think from Police Scotland's perspective, we do welcome the inclusion of rabbits. As I say, it would negate to an extent against the excuse that the dogs were hunting rabbits rather than hares.
And perhaps if anyone else wants to come in on that, Sarah Shaw.
I think it's a useful inclusion in the bill. It permits prosecution under an equivalent, the section one in the bill. Currently, if COPFS receive a report of alleged hare coursing and it turns out to be a rabbit that was involved, we do have the potential of raising proceedings under Section 11G of the Wildlife and Countryside Act. That's not to say that would be appropriate or possible in every scenario where rabbits are mentioned, but in appropriate cases that is an option currently open to us. The benefit of raising a prosecution under Section 1 of the bill in respect of a rabbit would be the penalties available under in this bill, obviously they add to what's currently in the 2002 Act.
If I may, convene from another perspective, I could ask Robbie Kernahan from Nature Scott again whether this distinction about misuse of animal or misuse of the law, as it were, on hare coursing and the distinction that's to be made between that and legitimate pest control of rabbits, again, if that distinction is clear enough or workable enough in the new bill. Basically, does the bill allow for adequate pest control?
Good morning, everybody. Nice to see you. And I think my starting point is, again, just to welcome the policy intention behind the bill. I mean, I think what we see in Nature Scott is clarity on purpose and tightening up and removal of any of those loopholes we've touched on to better protect welfare can only be a good thing from our perspective now, ultimately, hopefully leading to better enforcement of the law. In answer to your question, Alistair, I don't think there's anything in here which prevents effective control for a variety of purposes, and we can come on to those exceptions in due course, but there's nothing in here which we think would actually prevent legitimate wildlife management control from taking place effectively.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, Ariane Burgess has got a supplementary on offences, but could I ask you to also ask your question in the next section on exemptions, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thanks, panel. Good morning. I'm sorry that I can't be there in person today, and I really appreciate you all coming to add your perspective to this issue. So I wanted to pick up on a statement in the written evidence from the National Working Terry Federation, which I raised with Barry Wade from the organisation a couple of weeks ago. Their evidence states that it is commonplace on a shoot day to use more than two dogs while flushing game from cover. It goes on to say, we do not believe that the intention of the bill is to restrict, control, or interfere with normal shooting practices. But of course, the bill does restrict the number of dogs to two for game shooting and one for flushing game. When I questioned Barry on this, he admitted that you might be using three spaniels to flush ground game. If part of that ground game is rabbits, and if rabbits are part of the act, you are committing an offence. And I would like to ask Michael and then Sarah if you believe that this act, as worded, will indeed restrict so-called normal shooting practices, so that flushing to guns by using more than two dogs, whether you're flushing rabbits, foxes, or other wild mammals, will indeed be a prosecutable offence. So maybe I'll start with Michael.
Your question is yes. I think the bill is quite clear about that, that flushing with one dog and hunting with two is what's contained in the bill. And I don't see that that's unclear in any way.
And Sarah?
On the face of the bill, it's clear when an offence is being committed and when hunting with dogs falls within an exception. As to how that exactly plays out in practice, it's difficult to say. Obviously, each case turns on its own facts and circumstances, and how the law can be applied in each individual case, I can't comment on that, but certainly on the face of the bill, the offences and the exceptions appear to be relatively clear compared to the current legislation.
Thank you for that response. And I'm going to move on now to theme two, which is exceptions, and that's exceptions in section 3, 5, 6 and 7. So last week, Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn from the Scottish Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals stated that the purpose of the majority of the bill is to close loopholes in the Act. He related that under the Protection of Wild Mammals Act, every badger baiter said that they were after foxes and every hare courser said they were after rabbits. In order to prevent the situation continuing, Chief Superintendent Flynn stated that many terms have to be defined better and that the licensing provisions have to be specified and fleshed out if NatureScot is to have a reasonable chance of doing a good licensing job. I'd like to ask the panel if you agree with this statement and if you believe that this bill will close loopholes and remove ambiguities despite its many exceptions and its licensing scheme. And maybe I'll start with Michael again and then just go around everybody.
So the exceptions which are in the bill have had manifestations in many respects in previous legislation and, of course, in the 2002 Act, although not in this schematic way in which they're approached in the bill. And I think that lends a significant amount of clarity to the bill and allows for people to understand quite clearly what the exceptions are. It might be the case that if the government were to publish a sort of easy read guidance alongside the bill, that would be an additional help. I think that probably is our principal point on this. There are issues about some of the exceptions when one gets into them, and if I just were to highlight one which I thought was particularly problematic, which is the exception for environmental benefit, and in particular, I'd like to focus on the definition of invasive non-native species, means a species which is included in the Scottish list of species of special concern, and that is defined as meaning the list of species in the annex to the Commission Implementing Regulation 2016-1141, which has actually been part of or been implemented into our law by a piece of Brexit legislation, a regulation which allows for this annex to be adopted from being the Union list of species to the Scottish list of species. I don't know if any members of the committee have looked at it, but it's not entirely clear, to be honest, when looking at it, first of all, because it's a list which includes not only mammals, but also fish, and plants, and I think that we could do better to explain what species we're talking about, Having to trawl through all the Latin classification names, it was quite a chore. I did that yesterday. It just shows you how much time I had in my hands to do these things. Trying to track down what is a Corvus Splendus, we all know it's a splendid crow, but what's it doing there? And things like that, or Reeves Muntjac. I'm not entirely sure that many people would have the time, energy, or inclination to examine that fully. So there, that is an exact example of what I would say would be a point where the apparent clarity of the bill falls down adhering to the EU exit regulation, which is, I think, just not appropriate. And that's the Invasive Non-Native Species EU Exit Scotland Amendment Regulations 2020. On the point of licensing, well, Nature Scot would be easy. It would be an easier person to ask about this. It seems that Nature Scot do a lot of licensing, and I'm sure that they are well skilled in identifying how to license and the questions to ask to make sure that the license fits with the law. If you don't mind, I would divert my attention on that to Nature Scot for more authoritative answer.
Thank you, Michael, for your response on that and flagging up the species list to us. That does sound like a bit of an onerous task. Let's come to Robbie Kelman around my question. I don't know if I need to kind of recap it, but it was really picking up on Chief Superintendent Flynn's statements that many terms have to be defined better and that the licensing provisions have to be specified and fleshed out if Nature Scot is to have a reasonable chance of doing a good licensing job. So it's more about the clarity in these exceptions.
Thank you. I fully understand the point Mike Flynn was making last week. And there's two aspects to this. One, I suppose, is the exceptions within the bill. And let's be honest, the more exceptions there are, the less exceptional they become. So I think we do appreciate the clarity that they provide, but recognising that there is still quite a lot of work to do to translate some of this legislation to clear guidance for practitioners, and that's key to all of this, I think. The second point about the licensing regime, which also flows from some of these exceptions, I think is obviously the key part to make sure this bill is practicable and enabled. And I've heard quite a lot of the concerns from practitioners and others about the need to get that licensing regime right. And I suppose, by way of introduction, you know, we issue between 4,500 to 5,000 individual species licences on an annual basis. So we've got quite a lot of experience in being able to provide an enabling, targeted, risk-based approach to licensing in line with the principles of better regulation, and to try to do that in a way which is proportionate and transparent. So I think where we would pick this up is, you know, again, picking up on some of the ways of working which we've been advocating for a long time in relation to wildlife management, that we work together, we share the responsibility to come up with a licensing regime which is going to be accessible and fair and clear and practicable. And more importantly, again, coming back down to the policy intention behind this bill, is that it's consistent and enforceable. So, you know, we will work through that as need be, and you know, we might come in to discuss this in a bit more detail this morning about some of the detail therein about how prescriptive or not we want these licences to be, because there's a balance to be struck, I think, between providing that clarity and prescription at the same time as ensuring we've got flexibility in a licensing regime which can allow effective control of mammals where they're causing specific problems to public interest.
Thank you for that. That's very helpful. And I wonder if there's anybody else that wants to come in on this?
Just for
from the Police Scotland perspective, in terms of the definitions, we didn't really have any major issues within the exceptions. Just one point is that the term reasonable steps is used regularly. So, for example, in Section 3.3c, it states reasonable steps are taken to ensure that any dog used in the activity does not join with others to form a pack of more than two dogs. We just felt that the term reasonable steps is a wee bit subjective, so we would welcome perhaps either an amendment to that or some clarity via a kind of supplementary document to sort of detail what reasonable steps may be. On the licensing scheme, Police Scotland would welcome being involved in that scheme being drawn up, just so we can offer opinion on what kind of would make the scheme practical in terms of enforcement.
Thanks for that. That's actually really, it's great when you get specific like that. Thanks very much. And I just want to come in on the environmental benefits exception. So, Michael, you touched on the specifics of the species list. But some witnesses some witnesses and written evidence, notably RSPB and Scottish Badgers, have questioned the need for the exception and licences in connection to environmental benefit. And the League Against Cruel Sports highlighted the concern shared by many that this exception will be exploited and used as a smokescreen for traditional hunting with dogs. However, if this exception and licensing scheme will be retained, do you believe these sections would benefit from clearer definitions of terms such as significant or long-term environmental benefit and from guidance on how to determine whether each case meets these criteria? And maybe, Sarah, I'll come to you on that first.
I don't think I have a particular view to offer on the definition of terms such as significant or long-term environmental benefit. They seem fairly clear on the face of them. I think any difficulty in applying that in practice will come to light in a practical scenario when a case is before a court and someone's seeking to rely on that exception. From my perspective, from the prosecutor's perspective, I don't think I've got anything to offer in terms of taking issue with there being no particular definition in the bill. The terms that I've highlighted elsewhere that are used frequently, I'm not suggesting they need to be defined. I've just observed that they are not currently defined, and that includes search for, stalk and flush, retrieve. So there have been issues in some prosecutions around the definitions of terms in the Act. So I'm simply highlighting that there are still terminology that's repeated frequently throughout this bill that's not given a definition, and that's perhaps a point to be considered.
Thank you. We'll now move to Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Convener. Michael Clancy, I'm very quickly going to come back to you on a point, if that's okay. And it is taking a wee step back. We've kind of moved forward a wee bit quicker than I was thinking. Part 1, Section 1 of the Bill says, a person commits offence if the person hunts a wild animal using a dog. So it's kind of coming back. I just wanted your clarification from the Law Society's point of view. The clarity on a person walking a dog and a person who's using a dog. Do you have a concern about that specification?
Well, we I think set out in our written submission that we did have a concern about clarification might be necessary to improve understanding and consequently enforcement of Section 1, and that the using a dog when the hunting of a wild animal by that person involves the use of a dog. There is clearly a difference between walking a dog and using a dog. As I said earlier, the previous legislation said that it was hunt with a dog. We move into slightly new territory with this phraseology of using a dog. I have no doubt that the courts will be able to zero in on this phraseology, where if it causes any difficulty in bringing forward cases.
Can I interrupt you 1 wee second? I'm really conscious of time, so I may bring you into this as well. I want this to be really quick, I'm sorry. Let's imagine that William goes out and he finds three guys coming out of the back of a white van with three lurchers who say, yeah, we were just walking a dog. Does the court have a discretion to say, no, we find on the probability that you were coursing hares? Can you do that? Can the law do that?
Well, the responsibility for prosecution is with the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. The Crown has to prove an offence beyond reasonable doubt. So it's not...
Michael, can I suggest just for time purposes, this may be a question that Sarah should consider?
Yes, but Michael's absolutely right. The Crown do need to prove their case beyond reasonable doubt with corroborated evidence. We need to prove that there's a crime being committed and be able to prove who's committed that crime. And the crime is defined in this instance by what's in the legislation. So the Crown will have to have reference to the wording of the legislation and look at the evidence that's presented in the police report and consider whether the test is met and whether a prosecution can be brought. As to whether the scenario you describe would lend itself to a prosecution, I can't comment on because I don't have sufficient detail. Possibly not. Mm. There are circumstantial cases where there is a sufficiency of evidence. There are circumstantial cases where there isn't. I don't know if that quite answers your point or not. But
what it seems to highlight to me is that we need to try and get something in there that's a bit more robust. Would that be fair? Because we're trying to get the definition between somebody who's out walking their dog and the dog takes off and starts chasing a rabbit or chasing a hare, as opposed to somebody who has deliberately set out with a dog to go and hunt animals. And it's making that definition, because there's clearly been, William said it, there's a loophole or there's an easy way for somebody to say, I was just out walking my dog, the dog took off chasing a hare. But I know that guys go out with lurchers and greyhounds and they do it in a specific way. So it's how we make that bit more robust in order to, without just including rabbits in the legislation, is there another way for us to be able to find a way to make that particular part of the law more robust? That's what I'm trying to get to.
There may well be a way to do that. I do agree that there is merit in considering the use of the words intentional or reckless in terms of how this offence can be committed. I do think the inclusion of reckless as well as intentional allows certain scenarios that might present in practice to be brought within the ambit of the offence, which currently may not if it was left simply as being intentional. I appreciate the word intentional is not used, but it's implied in the wording of the bill. It might be worth highlighting that Lord Bonamy obviously highlighted in his report that the standard for reckless is high. It's not mere carelessness. So there is a distinction to be made between intentional, reckless, and other scenarios that don't quite fall into the ambit of criminal conduct.
Okay, that gives us something to think about. Robbie, I'm going to come to you now, if that's okay. Is Nature Scot content with the exception for environmental benefit from the perspective of your wildlife management schemes? Now, you can get a licence for up to 2 years for environmental benefit, but as the law stands at the moment, you've got 14 days to control a fox that's killing lambs. What is your perspective on that?
On the first point, in terms of the scope for environmental benefit, I don't think there's really much I will add. I mean, I think for our purposes, when we think about the need to allow to use dogs for biodiversity benefits, despite some of the clarity we can continue to present about the need for removal of invasive non-natives and how they are defined, I think the scope of the bill, from our point of view, is clear and we're quite comfortable with it. In terms of the consistency point about timescales for licensing, then I think my starting point is that it's far easier for us to be consistent, both in terms of defining licensable purpose and then the discretion we may have as a regulator to decide what we think the most appropriate licensing period is for any circumstances. But I think, again, coming back to the policy intention here, the policy intention is to try and restrict these exceptions. And again, let's be honest, these licences are derogations. They're enabling people to do things which would otherwise be an offence, and trying to strike the right balance between prescription and then reducing the likelihood of relying on those licences versus introducing flexibility is key for us.
Okay, but you're comfortable with the exception between environmental and ordinary wildlife management at the moment. We'll come on to licensing in more detail later on, but you're comfortable with it as it stands just now. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. I've got a quick question before I bring Alistair Allen in. Many weekends we will see mixed shoots where farmers will invite folk for the rural community in, and they'll bring their Labradors and they'll hunt and they'll retrieve and they're flushing pheasants or whatever to the gun. In that circumstance, we'll often see maybe half a dozen or more handlers, if you like, out enjoying that day quite legally, because the vast majority of country sports or country pursuits are still legal. William, it's a question for you. Do you think, given that there are some organisations out there who want to stop all shooting as a sport, do you think there's any risk that these mixed shoots, where more than two dogs are used, with maybe five or six or handlers to flush pheasants, if they flush a fox or flush a rabbit, would that then give doubt to whether their pursuit is legal or otherwise?
Yeah, I suppose that's a difficult one. That's where intent would come into it, and that might be difficult to differentiate. That opportunity is always going to be there if there's dogs flushing game out legally and they're there and they encounter a kind of mammal and chase it. That risk is there, I suppose, and I don't know if that is necessarily addressed by the bill.
Because that's really concerning, because we do have organisations out there who want to stop any sort of sport which involves the killing of an animal, whether that's a pheasant or a rabbit. But you'll know from your experience that if you send Labradors or whatever, or terriers into rough to raise pheasants or whatever, there's a good chance you will get rabbits or whatever, which will be shot currently legally now. Do you think there's a chance that every Saturday there's a mixed shoot on a farm that the League Against Cool Sports or One Kind or other organisations like that are on the phone to say that there's five dogs in that rough, they're hunting and they haven't got a licence? Do you think that's another difficulty that we're going to face in the future with this currently as the bill stands?
It may well happen, and I suppose we'll not know until it's introduced. If that was the case, Police Scotland, we're impartial. We would review all the circumstances, and including intent, and we would make a decision based upon that.
So that's the moment, because the last thing we want is law that has to be first tested in the courts and the appeals court. We want laws that are fit for purpose. Sarah, can I ask the same question? Is that going to cause a difficulty for you where intent, as I say, it'll happen every, if not on a daily basis, every week we will have people using dogs to for game shooting, for pheasants or whatever, which inevitably will cause rabbits and potentially other mammals to come in front of a gun?
I think that it just very much depends on the particular facts and circumstances of each scenario as to whether it can be said that the activity falls within one of the exceptions or not, because otherwise it's an offence under the bill. And as a prosecutor, we take each case on its own merits. So I think the scenario you've outlined is a possibility. Whether that can be better addressed in the legislation, I don't know. But, okay. But certainly, yes, there's scope for there to be a grey area there.
Okay, thank you. Very briefly, Jim.
Very briefly, and just on that point, if the scenario that Finlay is out here, wouldn't a dog then have to actually chase and kill that rabbit for it to have been an offence? Because generally, a Labrador or a Spaniel, if they're flushing, as soon as the bird goes up, they get back, their nose is back in the ground. They won't necessarily chase and kill it. So if they're flushing, does that become an offence if they don't actually chase the rabbit?
I think it's really difficult to comment specifically. It would all come down to exactly what had happened. It would need to be... We would need to look at the evidence, and we would need to look at the terms of the bill or the Act, assuming it's in force, and then consider whether an offence has been committed.
Okay, thank you. Michael Clancy would like to come in on that point.
Thank you, Convener. I think the bill makes it clear that the killing of an animal is not a requirement for hunting. Hunting includes, in particular, searching for and coursing. Doesn't say anything about then subsequently killing. On that point, I think there's no dubiety. And on the point of whether the courts have to interpret legislation, but that's what courts are for. It's not as if the Parliament, or indeed any Parliament, has enacted legislation which is not subject to interpretation by the courts. That's part of the process of making sure that the law is enforced. And we'd all love our laws to be crystal clear all the time, but the fact is people are human, and humans don't have that all-encompassing knowledge to make everything crystal clear from the start. We have to revisit it to take account of those different circumstances which Sarah has pointed out.
Thank you. That's helpful. Alistair Allen's got a brief supplementary on exceptions, then we're going to move to licensing.
Yes, just briefly on this question about that's been raised. I know it's been raised a few times about the example of the dog that slips the lead. He must be tired hearing about this particular dog, but would it be fair to say that the use of the word use in this bill is what deals with some of the question marks about that, in the sense that the intentions of the human rather than the intentions of the dog are what prosecutors would be interested in, and that use, does use encompass that clearly? Does the use of the word use, if that's not a tautology, make it clear in this bill that the examples that we have talked about numerous occasions about a dog slipping a lead have to do with the intentions of the dog, not the intentions of the owner, and therefore prosecution doesn't come into it? Is use an adequate way of dealing with the problem that we've been talking about?
I think the definition is clear, but the challenges still remain in proving that.
On the face of it, I think the bill sets out a clear offence. It's entirely possible that we will encounter difficulty in applying the wording in practice, but I can't comment on what that whether that will arise or not. There's certainly as we've already alluded to, there's a definition of using a dog in subsection 4 of section 1, which is useful. There is a definition of using a dog in the current Act, but it's not as specific. I think I'm correct in saying includes hunting with one or more dogs. This is a different approach in the bill. It's more specific as to what using a dog means, and seeks to encompass the activity of persons who may not be directly controlling or directing the dogs. There's certainly a broad definition there to encompass a number of participants in any activity.
But not the intentions of the dog?
No.
Thank you.
No. Thank you. We're now going to move on to focus on licensing and covered by sections 4, 8 and 9. Rachel Hamilton.
Okay, before I do that, could I get some clarity, maybe in writing, from the Crown and the and Police Scotland regarding the concern of the term reasonable steps in section 3C, when Lord Bonamy said that there were, that the courts would have no trouble with this expression. And I wondered why in other parts of law that the courts are unable to manage this expression, which is widely found in statute. So I'll move to licensing. So to Mr. Telford, Lord Bonamy noted that with or without licensing, the same difficulties of proof and enforcement would remain. What is your view of the licensing as set out in the bill in terms of that enforcement and proof?
I mean, I think from Police Scotland's perspective, all we could say about what's outlined in the bill is, you know, it seems fair enough. I think really it would be difficult to provide any further comment until we actually saw that the licensing scheme, which will have to be obviously very, very detailed to allow us to be able to enforce breaches of it. So I think that was probably where our involvement would be more relevant, and we would be keen to sort of be involved in drawing that out. But certainly definitions like, you know, area to be defined within the, or the area the licence is to be applied to, you know, something like that, we'd want a really, really clear definition as to what that area was. You know, are we talking about grid references? Are we, you know, what are we talking about here? That's the sort of thing for enforcement purposes we'd need to be really, really, really clear. Yeah,
I mean, that is, to use Michael Clancy's phrase, is proof in eating the pudding, because, you know, we've heard that there could be issues with movement of animals between A to B. You know, animals don't see boundaries or marches, mm-hmm. and therefore that's where the difficulty lies within the role that Nature Scot will play in the licensing. Can I just ask you, keep asking you some sort of quick-fire questions here? Lord Bonamy also suggested amending the Act coupled with a code of practice for hunts and the introduction of monitors. And the code of practice was introduced, but not the monitors. And is there any evidence that this approach has worked, or indeed, it, you know, that combination of the approach can work?
That's not something I could answer. I don't know at this stage, but I can certainly find out and reply to you along with the other details you requested.
But surely, since the first Act, you've got evidence to suggest that, you know, what has been. And given some examples of that in terms of enforcement.
So, sorry, could you clarify the
question? Well, so the code of conduct was introduced.
Yeah.
How has enforcement worked so far for Police Scotland?
In relation to the code of conduct?
Mm.
I don't know. I'll need to find it and get back to you.
Okay. In England and Wales, proportionately, there have been no more prosecutions than in Scotland. And what specific changes within this bill do you see that would make prosecutions easier in terms of the way that the offences and exceptions are defined within the bill?
I think the removal of the word deliberate creates less confusion. As I said earlier, that the inclusion of rabbits, I think, will negate against hare coursing or false hare coursing excuses. I think that would be the most significant features.
Okay. The bill may see greater use of firearms in the countryside as land managers try to deal with the predation in the absence of dogs. Is this a concern for you? Is it something that you have considered?
Police Scotland will always react to any relevant offences. We've got a firearms licensing team, a rural crime team. So, you know, if issues do arise, we will deal with them accordingly. There's been firearms in the rural community for, you know, 100 years. So the majority of sort of the agricultural community know how to use them responsibly and legally. So I don't think there's any undue concern at this stage or evidence that you know, to cause any concern.
Okay. And you note in your written evidence that the bill contains no provision for police powers of arrest and search. Can you explain why the general powers available to Police Scotland and those set out in the schedule to the bill could be a problem?
I was just looking for a bit of clarity around that, just as there wasn't anything in there. At the moment, the powers afforded by the Protection of Wild Mammals Act and the Wildlife and Countryside Act and kind of other wildlife crime legislation is really effective. You know, it affords us powers of search of persons, which is absolutely key in gaining evidence of, you know, of offences. And again, talking about hair coursing, you know, that allow us to take phones, to potentially get evidence of phones, you know, footage or so forth. So the powers, we would hope that the powers afforded in this bill would sort of be similar as the current legislation.
Okay. And do you think that, I mean, I think Robbie Kernahan was saying that they issue thousands upon thousands of licences per year. In terms of that sort of 14-day licence, it'd be interesting to hear in the next part of this questioning how this will play out and what will be required of Nature Scot. But in terms of the resource that is required from Police Scotland, so do you believe, or has Police Scotland considered that a general licence with conditions and reporting requirements would be a better way of conducting this in terms of the current resources that you do have to make any enforcement?
It's not something we've considered, to be honest.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I would like to ask, William, and good morning to the panel, incidentally. What sort of role would you see Police Scotland having in regards to licensed activities? Would you expect to be notified beforehand? Would that be part of the collaboration that you'd want to see on this?
I don't necessarily think so. Again, that's something we would perhaps like to discuss when the scheme's been drawn up with Nature Scot and so forth. At the moment, we've got a really close working relationship with Nature Scot. So as things emerge, we sort of have those discussions. We don't necessarily always need to know this is exactly what licensing conditions, you know, are in relation to ABC. If issues arise, we can contact, and we do contact Licensing Scot, Nature Scot, sorry, and likewise they will discuss that with us. So that avenue of conversation is already there anyway, so I don't think we necessarily need to be overly intrusive.
Okay, no, that's really helpful. So there are elements of trust there in regards to how people would generally be going about their business and conducting these hunts. And just following on, I mean, you probably answered this a bit to Rachel's question, but you touched upon that need for collaboration when it comes to, you know, policing and prosecution into the licensing. Could you give us any examples of what you would like to see within that?
I just think off the top of my head, really just the ease of communication and information sharing, which we've already got with the partner agencies already, to be honest. That's already there. What I think is key is a licensing scheme that is, you know, really, really detailed, and I sort of appreciate there's the challenges of, you know, dogs moving from A to B, so it's maybe not that easy to define areas. But for enforcement purposes, we kind of really need something that's, you know, pretty black and white, you know, really, really detailed for us to enforce.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to move on to questions relating to Nature Scot's position. Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Convener. And Robbie, I'm coming back to yourself again. What's your position as the proposed licensing authority, including what resources Nature Scot would require to fulfil the role, and whether that is adequately provided for in the financial memorandum? I point out that in previous sessions, generally people are content with Nature Scot being the licensing authority, because as you've said, you've issued thousands of them. But what there were some concerns with, in particularly in the sort of rural pursuit and farming of, groups, was your staff having the full understanding of the circumstances under which they were trying to manage particular species of wildlife, particularly foxes.
Thank you, Jim. I mean, as we move on to licensing, I mean, it is quite interesting here to try and think about how we can balance and manage all of these expectations placed upon us. But again, my starting point is we've been dealing with species licenses to try and prevent serious damage to a range of interests for quite a long time. So I think there is something here about how we try and put together a licensing scheme, which, you know, satisfies Police Scotland's desire for absolute clarity and certainty and prescription to work out whether offences have been committed, versus the flexibility that practitioners need to be able to make on-site decisions as circumstances arise in a fairly dynamic way. And I think, you know, when we talk about how we manage serious damage to livestock from ravens or from other protected species, whether issues with badgers or indeed some other protected birds, we've got a good track record on that. So I think we're in a good place to continue these conversations once this, you know, once the parliamentary process is concluded and we actually see the nature of the bill and therefore what we've got to work with to design a scheme. But again, please take some reassurance that we will commit to that shared approach, working together with all of the relevant parties to try and come up with a licensing regime which is proportionate. And I come back to some of our frustrations actually about the lack of knowledge we have at the moment. Come back to, can we resource this work? We don't fully understand the demand. We don't really know what the demand for licensing solutions will be. I would hazard a guess that the majority of effective mammalian control, and certainly fox control, is carried out without the reliance on some of the packs that we've heard you discuss over the last 2 or 3 weeks. I would hazard a guess that 90% of fox control is actually undertaken effectively using shooting both during the day and at night and snaring. So yeah. I suspect it's a relatively small proportion of fox control that we're talking about here, but we won't really understand that until we start receiving that demand. And at that point, we can begin to continue to evolve the approach about what we think is adaptive and proportionate and get that burden right, because, you know, in terms of defining damage, for example, a lot of that is in the eye of the beholder.
I'm not going into the next question, I'm continuing with that one.
Robbie, can I just ask you, the Scottish Government have said they're going to publish guidance, and on the back of Jim's question, that's going to be absolutely critical to how the licence system works. Have you been involved in looking at putting that guidance together up to now? And if not, will you be? And have you got any idea of when those guidance notes, if you like, will be published before the bill turns into an act? And do you know whether it will be consulted on?
Well, I mean, I think that in terms of the detail, convener, we have been involved in discussions with Scottish Government colleagues up until this point. But, you know, as we go through the parliamentary process, it may well be that the licensing regime must evolve in relation to whatever may come by way of amendment. So, you know, we will work within the legislative constraints in order to design a licensing scheme which best meets people's expectations. And we can only do that in consultation, as we've heard from practitioner groups and others who have got a stake in this. So I can't put a definitive timeline on that at this particular point in time, but happy to come back to you if you would like some more clarity on it.
Yeah, that would certainly be helpful to get an idea of timescales and consultation timescales, whatever. That would be helpful.
Thank you, Robbie. I'm going to come back in there. One of the points I was making to you earlier on was about the timescales of a licence, and Rachel alluded to it, the 14 days as opposed to the 2 years for environmental. You've got 14 days to deal with a fox. And I think from a practitioner's, from a land manager's point of view, a 14-day timescale for to try to deal with a predatory fox is too late, and it's too prescriptive from the point of view of, well, you're going to wait till they start killing lambs, you know that it's coming out of a wood. And I could go through all the scenarios, you know the scenarios, Toll. I don't need, you know, translate them to you again. How do you feel about the licence for particularly fox control? And I don't take Rachel's point of view that we need more guns in the countryside, because walked packs do that anyway. So
What is your view on having an extended seasonal licence or an annual licence for specific walked packs to try to control foxes in particular areas?
Yeah, well, I think as a licensing authority and as a regulator, we've actually got quite a lot of discretion, Jim, to decide how we want to implement a licensing scheme. You know, and we can be very specific and tight about that within a specific seasonal window. If that's the desired direction of travel, that would constrain, I suspect, quite a lot of the flexibility which practitioners currently benefit from. But you know, my understanding of the policy intention behind this bill is to try and reduce the reliance on the use of more than two dogs as far as we are able. So, you know, the opposite end of that spectrum is we can issue a general licence with specific conditions attached to it, which would allow a more flexible approach to something which is quite well established and commonplace, but quite clearly setting out conditions about how we would expect people to operate. And there's something in between as well in terms of a class licence, which you know people made reference to over the last couple of sittings, where we licence a trusted operator to act in accordance in a certain way and report back to us. So there's a range of licensing solutions in here that I wouldn't necessarily want to pin my colours to the mast exactly at this particular point. And you know, I also like that as a licensing service, we're constantly seeking to improve based on evidence and feedback. So whatever we decide to implement by way of a licensing scheme on day one, when this bill receives royal assent and we're into licensing, might not necessarily tie us to that approach ad infinitum. I think we would need to learn as we go. And you have also heard from contributors to discussions today is that we will need to learn as we go as a licensing authority, because this is new territory for us. And we would need to work quite closely with those practitioner groups to help design something which is going to work for them, but secure the safeguards in place that we know this bill is trying to achieve.
Yeah, okay. So a lot of the stuff that we've talked about just now has been particularly based around hunting with dogs for foxes. That's where a lot of the controversy has been. But as we've just seen this morning, we're speaking to Sarah and William, that it actually goes into other areas. Do you think that the wider review and species licensing committed by the Scottish Government and what impact this particular scheme has on that?
So, again, as part of the Bute House Agreement, there's a commitment to look afresh at how Nature Scot discharges its licensing functions. And that is probably because we are regularly tripping up against about these types of questions about how transparent we are, about how proportionate we are, about the complexity of operating, you know, heavily amended legislation, the Wildlife and Countryside Act, which provides the majority of our licensing functions, is complicated and complex, and the licensing tests don't necessarily reflect what's in the Protecting the Badgers Act, which is different from the conservation regulations in the Deer Scotland Act. There are all subtle differences in law about the tests which need to be applied for different purposes and for different species, and that's confusing. And again, I come back to the points within this bill. As a licensing authority, we will need to be absolutely satisfied that there is a clear licensable purpose, that there's evidence that there's something we need to allow, and that there's no satisfactory alternative. So the types of questions we would be posing to applicants who are suffering damages, well, what other alternatives have you implemented before we rely on something which would otherwise be an offence?
Oh, I'm going to just pursue that one point very quickly. I promise I'll be quick on this. From a previous licensing experience, I have gone through that, proven the damage, the effect, got the licence, and it became very easy thereon. We already know that foxes predate lambs during lambing time. As a farmer, and I've asked this question already in previous sessions, as a farmer going to have to come to you with pictures of dead lambs with tails off and ears off to prove that a fox has killed them, or would you be comfortable to say, we know that foxes will kill lambs prior to lambing, there could be a good reason for a licence?
So again, cards on the table, there is no doubt at all that predation of livestock takes place from foxes, and we are quite clear of that. So there is a licensable purpose, which is why preventing serious damage to livestock is in the bill. The burden of proof to evidence that, again, I think is part of the discussion which we need to have in putting together a licensing scheme, because we can take a very light touch with that and be quite enabling, and let's be honest, We are wanting to prevent damage rather than necessarily react to damage which is occurring, because that does incur quite a lot of financial loss and trauma for those people suffering it, and we want to be enabling. So I think these are the types of conversations in which we would need to be clear with applicants about where the burden of proof lies with them in order to demonstrate clear and evidential need.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Ariane. Can I just remind members we've got about 15 minutes for a further 10 questions, so we can keep them nice and succinct. Ariane Burgess.
There is more questions for you, and you kind of started to go through the kind of things you would ask people to demonstrate if they're applying for a licence. But I mean, just to say that in discussions I've had with people around this this bill, I've actually heard that, you know, we've got this situation where we're killing foxes to protect lambs year after year without actually any long-term improvement. So there's no reduction in the local fox population, and there's no better lamb retention rate. And last week we heard from One Kind and League Against Cruel Sports that they're opposed to licensing schemes because they fear they'll create new loopholes that will allow the continuation of hunting with dogs for sports. However, if a licensing scheme will be retained, I'd be interested to hear what you think about, and these groups and other organisations have called for this, aligning the licensing scheme with the international principles for ethical wildlife control. So that in order to obtain a licence, applicants would have to demonstrate that they're complying with those principles. What are your thoughts about that?
I think this one's for Robbie.
Thank you, Ariane. And I think, yeah, I agree entirely with the principle that we want our licensing. And there needs to be some kind of means by which we can monitor and receive feedback in order to continue to refine the licensing regime to ensure that it actually does deliver what it says on the tin. So would Nature Scotland issuing licences at certain times of year or in a certain way or using certain methods address the problem in terms of whether it's damage to livestock, damage to arable, protecting ground nesting birds? We need to be clear that that licensing regime is effective. So that does require a certain amount of adaptive management to learn by experience. And I think we have that, you know, we have that for other species licensing regimes where we are continually trying to receive information and improve the process, both from a practitioner point of view, but also from a conservation point of view, and certainly from a welfare perspective, which is, again, an integral part of this bill. And in terms of aligning our approach with the ethical principles, I think we are fairly well aligned, both by the shared approach, which we published and worked up in conjunction with other partners. And the first point of that is, well, do we need to modify human behaviour? These are the types of questions which we ask in a licensing regime. What other satisfactory alternatives have you explored before relying on something which would otherwise be illegal? Are there any non-lethal methods which you have used? Are there other methods which you've used which might involve killing mammals, which don't rely on something which would otherwise be an offence? So again, I've referenced snaring and shooting as perfectly legitimate means to allow effective fox control. Please demonstrate to us why they're not effective in your particular circumstances.
Okay, we're now going to move on to the next section on prohibition on trail hunting. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. I think my questions are probably for William. I understand that the trail hunting prohibition has been introduced to take preemptive action to prevent trail hunting becoming established here in Scotland. So what are your views on whether this will assist policing and prosecution of hunting with dogs? And I'll just roll in my second question, which was I'd be interested to hear your views on the exception to allow the training of dogs to follow an animal-based scent and the implication of this for training dogs such as police dogs.
So I suppose making trail hunting illegal, it would limit the opportunities for those that wanted to undertake illegal fox hunting, disguising it as a legal act. But I know that alone isn't necessarily a reason to sort of make the trail hunting illegal itself. The evidence doesn't indicate that what little trail hunting there is in Scotland is used as a guise for criminality although I believe it is at times in England. In terms of the training of dogs, we did, Police Scotland do have a bit of concern around that, in that there's obviously an exemption to allowing dogs to be trained using animal-based scents, providing no more than two dogs are being trained at once. Cadaver dogs in Police Scotland and presumably other kind of emergency services are trained using animal-based scents, and often that's up to six dogs are being trained at once. So that would potentially create logistical issues for us. So we would be keen that there was some sort of exemption built in for sort of emergency dogs.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. We'll now move on to enforcement, which is part three of the bill. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel, for coming along. A quick question that may require a longer answer. I'm just interested to hear about your views on the enforcement powers in the bill and whether they are providing adequate, effective and proportionate powers for policing and prosecution. And I think if I come to William Telford first, please.
Yeah, of course. So, in terms of powers afforded here of premises out with a domestic dwelling house, they're very, very similar to powers afforded in the Protection of Wild Mammals Act. Where I'd actually sort of sought clarification in my call to views was that there doesn't seem to be any reference to arrest powers of persons or search of persons. So we'd certainly be keen that, you know, I know there's criticism of the Protection of Wild Mammals Act, but what I will say is that the powers afforded in that legislation are really, really effective. So we would sort of like that full range of powers available in this bill as well.
Because that was one of the thoughts I was having, is consistency with other acts, and then also there's the protection of livestock that's been upgraded in the beginning of this session, the end of last session as well. So what consistency there is in this act with previous acts.
Yeah, very much so, and certainly the powers afforded across various wildlife legislation, the Protection of Badgers Act, Wildlife and Countryside Act, Protection of Wild Mammals Act, is very, very consistent, which does kind of make enforcement that bit more straightforward. You know, you're not having to sort of think, well, if I'm using that legislation, I've got those powers. Actually, there is consistency there, and that is a really valuable tool for the wildlife crime officers on the ground. Okay. Who are enforcing it.
Thank you very much. And Michael Clancy, I know in the Law Society's written evidence, you've made some comments about perhaps definition, lack of definition under consent or connivance. And then also I think you questioned around the three-year prosecution window. Is there anything you'd like to add?
I don't think so. In fact, when I was looking at the three-year period in preparation for this meeting, I saw that earlier legislation had similar time limits, and so I'm going to say that I stand by what the Criminal Law Committee said, but I will raise it with my colleagues to deal with Criminal Law Committee as to whether or not maybe a supplemental letter might be in order to the committee.
Okay, thank you.
Robbie indicated he'd like to comment, I think, on the previous question. Robbie.
Thank you. And it was just to come back on that point on trail hunting before we leave it entirely. I think it would be remiss of me not to make it quite clear that use of dogs is an integral part of wildlife management. And from our perspective, we need to ensure that use of dogs is still permissible for some very specific things. So it's a condition at the moment for any night shooting license that we issue for wild deer that the stalker or hunter has a dog available to them for follow-up. So we know that in order to enable those provisions, we need to allow dogs to be trained for that purpose. So the use of training for dogs, certainly for deer management purposes and indeed for specialist tracking for dealing with invasive non-natives, mammalian invasive non-natives, is pretty key for us in order to realise our vision for a nature-rich future. So it's just to make sure that that is on the committee's radar. I know that it is, but it's quite important that we retain the ability to use dogs for those purposes.
Thank you. Jen, do you want to continue?
Thank you. Just, Sarah, I wondered if you had any comments with regard to the enforcement sections of the bill.
I don't think I've got anything in particular to add to what William has already said. I'm also aware that there's consistency with the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act. I'm aware from discussions with Scottish Government colleagues that there's a consistency of approach with, even with that piece of legislation. So that's to be welcomed.
OK, thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I was really just to ask on the business of enforcement whether you are content with what the bill now says around the restrictions potentially for an individual on the keeping of a dog or indeed the restrictions on them having a particular horse. So I wonder if perhaps Sarah Shaw and William Telford could say anything about that.
Sorry, is this in respect of deprivation orders?
Deprivation orders, I meant, sorry.
From the Police Scotland perspective, we just had one suggestion for an addition to the deprivation order, and that is a person should be, shouldn't be permitted to reside in the same house as a dog. That's to negate against the excuse it's my wife's dog or it's my son's dog, and that is an excuse we do encounter.
I simply welcome the option to have a court impose a deprivation order following conviction. I think it's a useful tool to have. Obviously, sentencing is a matter entirely for the court, but I think it's a really useful option to have available.
And finally, a question for Robbie Kernahan. I appreciate it's not about quite the same subject, but we have heard it put to the committee that there might be an increase in the number of guns in the countryside as a result of this. And I know that you touched on this before, Robbie, but can you say a bit more about your views on whether that's actually likely or not?
Well, again, quite difficult to be specific about it without really fully understanding the demand in terms of from a licensing perspective. But one of the issues which we regularly deal with is the lack of firearms holders, certainly in an agricultural setting, whereby we've got an ageing farming population, certainly an ageing crofting population, that are maybe not as active in terms of managing wildlife with firearms as they perhaps were. So that is something which you know, in terms of capacity to deal with some of the issues that this bill is looking at, that's something we are very aware of in managing wildlife conflicts. We still need to have a strong base of skilled practitioners who know what they're doing. For a variety of wildlife management reasons.
Thank you.
I've got a question specifically for the Law Society. You mentioned in your evidence about the ancillary powers in Part 4 of the bill, and you know the regulations under the section may make different provisions for different purposes and be modify any enactment, including this Act. You know, even I, as someone who's not a lawyer, would suggest that was a very, very wide power, which could potentially allow ministers to make modifications to that without parliamentary scrutiny. Can you comment further on that, Michael Clancy, please?
Yes, we have a general ongoing concern about ministerial powers to make regulations and, of course, regulations under Section 21 of the bill will make different provision for different purposes. That's a pretty ordinary provision. But modifying any enactment, including this Act, seems quite broad. I think that although that is contained to regulations under that section, that is changes which are incidental, supplementary, consequential, transitional or transitory or saving provisions, nevertheless it's very broad, and we would suggest At the very least, Scottish ministers should be required to consult upon such regulations with such persons as they consider appropriate.
Thank you very much. And Rachel Hamilton.
Okay, so two quick questions on the back of Alistair Allen's. What facilities and storage do the police have to seize a horse or store a quad bike, and who pays for that? And this is sort of to most of the witnesses, but if there's a spurious allegation, Robbie Marsden was talking about field investigators, I think. Perhaps it was an allegation from a field investigator. Will a licence be revoked on site or revoked on conviction? And if a farmer suffers loss of livelihood, should there be compensation? And Nature Scot would know how general licences work, but there's no there's nothing in the bill that suggests that there could be compensation or there could be a method of appeal on a conviction. Who wants to take that? Robbie, do you want to take it on the basis of the general licensing that is operated? Thanks.
Yeah, happy to respond to that, Rachel. So there's, from a regulator's point of view, when we are discharging our licensing, from, I've said we've got quite a lot of discretion about how we do that. And generally, licences that we issue are based on trust and confidence. So as a regulator, if we're beginning to lose trust and confidence in how a licence is being complied with, we can revoke it and we can remove it. And that doesn't have to be on the basis of any criminal issues. And indeed, we have got experience of doing exactly that on the balance of probability that an offence has been committed out. So we already, as colleagues have mentioned, we have a relationship with Police Scotland where we keep in touch about potential offences taking place and then how we will reflect on that as a regulator. So I think we're fairly well versed in making sure we how conditions are prescribed in licence and then what we might want to do by way of follow-up. And you know, we can talk about compliance monitoring if we needed to as part of the licensing scheme. But on the point about compensation, again, that's not something which we generally engage with through any of our losses as a result of wildlife management or predation. Whilst we engage with practitioners to think about mitigation and we maybe incentivise schemes to help people live with wildlife, very rarely do we actually compensate specifically for loss.
Okay, that's interesting. And on the point about the, again, resource facilities.
In terms of seizure of quad bikes, we would have provision for that. You know, we do seize vehicles regularly, so there's provision for uplifting the vehicles and storage. Horses are perhaps a different matter. Provisions would need to be put in place. I don't imagine, you know, if we do seize horses, it's anything that will be happening regularly. Obviously, the priority is going to have to be the welfare of the animal. So that is something we will perhaps need to look at.
And where the horse goes on beyond that as well.
Yeah, that's right. You know, we do seize dogs, so there's arrangements there, and you know, there is funding sources as well. So yeah, that is something we will need to look at.
Thank you. Very finally, the decision not to provide for vicarious liability or reverse burden of proof. Police Scotland said they weren't in favour but didn't actually give any reason for that. And could you give us the reason why you didn't think it was a good tool in your box, so to speak, to have a vicarious liability or reverse burden of proof in the bill?
We felt that in terms of vicarious liability, there was a list of potentially relevant persons that will be liable for prosecution, and we felt that was that was suitably detailed.
Okay, and can I ask Michael Clancy on his views on that those points?
Of course, Lord Bonamy went into this in some depth in his report, convener, and I think for shortness of time, perhaps we could write to you about vicarious liability and reverse burden. We're not in favour of reversing the burden. It should be the prosecution's obligation to prove beyond reasonable doubt. I think that probably is where I would like to leave it at the moment.
Thank you. And very finally, Sarah Shaw, do you have any comments on make clarity and whatever, would those provisions have made it easier for you, or do you not have a position?
Not necessarily. I note in the policy memorandum that there wasn't an evidential basis for it wasn't considered that there was an evidential basis for introducing an offence of vicarious liability, and based on the provision in section 2.1, I think it is, in 2.1, it was considered that there wasn't a need that offence, in a sense, addressed the area of vicarious liability, although not directly.
Okay. Thank you very much. We've run over time slightly, so thank you very much for your attendance today. That's been most helpful, certainly the evidence we've heard today will help us form our Stage 1 report. We're now going to briefly suspend to allow witnesses to leave, and we will have a short comfort break and resume at 11:10. Welcome back, everybody. Our next item of business is consideration of the Scottish Government's Aquaculture Regulatory Review. And a welcome to the meeting, Professor Russell Griggs, OBE, whose review of the regulatory framework for the aquaculture sector and recommendations for change have been made, have been the first stage of the review. So we're going to have some questions to take us up to around about 10 past 12. I'll kick off. Can you give us your views on what the current stakeholder relationship and trust in the decision-making process from your engagement with the industry and communities is?
Okay. Yes, I can. I suppose in simple terms, I would say not very good. And I think that's based on a number of factors. This is an industry that's developed since, 1970, when it started off as a little cottage industry, really, and it's now grown into, in part of it, a very sophisticated industry with some very sophisticated decisions got to be needed to it. So, over time, as it's become more complex, each of the partners involved have their own issues around whether they do this. And I mean, as I said in my report, it's the only one of these reviews I've ever done where nobody, and I do mean nobody, wanted to retain the status quo, and that the relationship between some of the stakeholders had got to a point where it wasn't just about trust of the organisation, it was about trust of individuals inside the organisation. Based on a whole load of things, whether those things are true or not doesn't really matter, they're perceived as being true. So the one thing we have to do, and that's what I thought all the way through as we go back into this, is to put in place a system that tries to restore that trust. And part of that is by making it robust enough that everybody gets their voice. But based on a simple three-part process, I guess, that government makes policy, regulators and planning authorities put that policy into place, and industry and other stakeholders comply and do that. And it's about then how you change the vet. But no, if I say on a couple of occasions, the two civil servants who accompanied me round in this had to cover up their ears on some of the comments that were being made by people, then I suspect that would be my easiest way of describing how much the feeling is felt out there.
So you've obviously have years of experience of big industry and communities and so on, and you're well aware of the pressures that are, for example, with the local communities and renewable energy in the south of Scotland. Is it similar with communities and fish farms? And is there scope for that to improve, or do we need to start making improvements now to make sure both communities and industries thrive?
I think that's a very big question, if I may say so, and let me try and do it in some parts. I think one of the challenges of all communities at the moment is deciding what is the voice of the community. And I think that's getting much more complex and much more difficult as we go on. And as you know, there's been this whole debate over the last 6 months around second homes, people that don't live in communities for all year. And so I suppose there's now what you would call an economically active part of a community and an economically inactive part of a community. And it's about which voice should have the biggest say in community decisions, not just about renewables or indeed about fish farms, but indeed a whole load of things. And it's quite clear from the work I did on this that the voice, the anti-voice in some places, is very well funded, it's very well resourced, which perhaps the local voice isn't. So it's about trying to bring into that some balance, so that we understand when we're listening to voices, it's not just the loudest that should get their way, but it should be one that's based on evidence. And there is no doubt, if you look in the communities involved in fish farming, they have economically benefited well and will continue to do so going forward as they go forward. And some of the negative or people that don't want it come at it from a very different view, which is much more to do with their view on what rural life should be, which, interestingly enough, may not be the way that those that have lived there for decades, etc., will put in place. Do I think communities get enough say in this? No, I don't. which is why I've recommended within my report that there needs to be a social contract built in to any of these things that we take forward. And indeed, once we get to figuring out how much the industry is going to pay to get these licences, if that's what we want to call them, then there has to be more of a part of it that goes back to the community, not just the jobs and the other bits of infrastructure that they get.
So you mentioned some communities being well funded, but my issue is always whether the evidence is well founded. So funding and founding are two similar things, but can drive a different outcome. Are there plans to put the right mechanisms in place to make sure that we do have peer-reviewed evidence and whatever, so it's not a polarised argument?
Part of my recommendation, as you know, is that there should be a scientific body in the middle of this that reviews all evidence. Because one of the things I saw as I did all this, and I've talked about 90 different organisations and people, was an array of scientific evidence that would take you from one end to say that there's nothing going on at all, to another end that say the world is about to end. So we need somebody in the middle of this to judge that. But that scientific evidence, I think, is slightly different to the point that you're making about communities, in that now, because communities are comprised of different types of people, people that have lived there all their life and want to work, and people that have gone there for different reasons to do that, we need to find a balance of listening to those voices. And when I say it's well-resourced, there's no doubt in a couple that I looked at is that the reporter who was doing the evidence of it was ambushed by the bits of the community that didn't want it because they were well-organised, and the bits that didn't want it, sorry, the bits that did want it weren't well enough organised. So I think there's two issues here. I think there's one about the scientific evidence. We need to have some central look at that. But I think there's a much wider social debate about, as we start to look at everything from fish farming to second homes to rural housing, as Rachel and I were exchanging verbally on a minute, about how we deal with community input and who we listen to. And it's a really, really challenging subject, so it's not something easy. So I think there's two bits. The scientific bit and what I was looking at, I think, is really, really straightforward. The more social impact of how we change or regard the changing nature of some of our rural communities is a different issue.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Convener. And Professor Griggs, I'm joining virtually. I'm very sorry that I can't be with you today. So it was interesting to hear your perspective around community, and thanks for doing all that work. But, you know, I've been speaking to coastal communities as well. And, you know, I speak to people who, you know, earn their living catching crabs and lobsters. It's, you know, the coast is where they swim. It's where their children play. And also, of course, tourists come to, you know, enjoy diving and water sports, and they bring money into the local economy as well. And they don't want the fish farms. So, you know, it is an interesting bit that you're talking about who is the community. And they don't want the fish farms, even if they would receive a payment, as they would, you know, many of them actually see it as being bought off. So you were talking about a recommendation of a single consenting document, and it doesn't seem to include a mechanism for community to reject the imposition of a new or expanded industrial fish farm in their local waters. So I'd like to hear your thoughts on the principle that coastal communities should have a say in where fish farms are located.
I think, and if I haven't put it properly, there is in my recommendation on who gets involved in the consenting process. The community is in there, and the community is one of the bodies that would have to be statutorily consulted. So I guess what I'm saying, and from my previous remarks, is about the community has to decide who that voice is. And how we do that, we have to have a long debate about. But no, I believe strongly in the community having a view. The challenge with communities is there will be different voices. And it's about how you listen to those different voices within that. I spoke to lots of coastal community groups as I went through my work on doing this. And I think the way that fish farming is developing now, and especially finfish, we'll put shellfish and seaweed to one side, will become much bigger, but much less intrusive, if I can put it that way, in coastal waters, because most of it will be done on land, and it's probably only going to be the last year or so that we see fish out in the water as we move forward. So I think I think part of the challenge in all of this, and I say in my report, I hadn't visited a fish farm for 20 years until I started to do this. And my goodness, was I shocked when I went and visited some of the new fish farms that are really sophisticated, technical pieces of infrastructure where the majority of the development of the fish is done on land and it's only the latter part that is done on sea. Now, that's very different from what you would call the traditional fish farms that were set up from the 1970s onwards. And I guess the industry would even accept that not all of those are in the optimal position if you had this wonderful position called hindsight. And that's why one of the other recommendations in the report is to say, as we go through this, we need to look at where all the fish farms are currently and in the future and see if they're in the right place.
Okay, thank you for that reassurance, because you know, it was in conversation with coastal communities that they felt that they weren't going to be recognised in this issue, but it's good to hear that you are concerned and that you're wanting to make sure that they do have a voice.
Let's be very precise. I think the community should have a voice. Who that voice is for the community to decide.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Professor.
Good morning.
I would like to ask, what are your main observations on the key issues with the current regulatory framework?
Okay, I think my main... I've been doing this for a while, and there's no doubt that if you look at any planning or development process, the best way to do it is to start before you do it. So you get all the interest. So if you want to do something, you get all the interested parties around the table before we even get to filling in the application form to decide what the issues are that we're all going to have to deal with as we go forward. And that's what's got this very sexy name of multilateral pre-consultation, which is not, but that's what it is. And that's why I believe that it's worked very effectively, for example, in offshore wind in the last. So that's why my view is that the way this is done at the moment, which is to leave everybody to do their own bits, just doesn't work.
Okay.
Because they do them sequentially. They don't have to do them sequentially, but they tend to do. The developer can only talk to one of the interested partners until he wants to talk to another one. So my view is the only way any of these things work, especially when they're complicated, which these things are, and especially when it doesn't happen that often. This is not something that's coming in front of a planner or SEPA or anybody else every day of the week. They probably get 3 or 4 of these a year. So it's not something you're building up an expertise on as you do it all the way through. So the best way at the beginning is, in a managed format, is to get everybody around the table to say, here's what I want to do. What are the issues going to be resolved in that? Can we resolve those or not? And what would we have to do with it? Because developers will also tell you that having a no as early as they can get is as good as having a yes as early as they get. So my view is that this is like a lot of bits of the planning system where it's not joined up.
Okay.
And it's not difficult. It's not rocket science to join it up. It's a bit more challenging and needs a bit more work, but in the end, you get a much better end result. So that when the application ends up going in, all the parties around the table have more or less agreed in it, so it should go through the system, more smoothly. Whereas at the moment, all the back and forth and all the fun, and I've got some numbers if you're interested that show that every part of the system is way over their statutory obligations on how long they should take to do things. So they're not fulfilling any of the targets they've given themselves to do this by miles, not just by the odd day, by miles. So, and that's because we do it piecemeal. So somebody will go and speak to the planning department, then they'll go and speak to SEPA, then they'll go and speak to Nature Scot. And then Nature Scot might speak to SEPA, they might speak to the planning department. So there's no continuity or cohesion within the process.
You touched upon communication there, and that's what I was thinking in terms of investors and stakeholders, maybe not necessarily. So what you're saying there, it's not necessarily the communication that people are bringing forward, but maybe the understanding of the framework, their understanding of it bringing forward, and maybe, you know, misunderstanding, miscommunication there.
It is. So, for example, SEPA might have a scientific view on one part of it. The developer might have a different scientific view on it. What we need to do is take those two scientific views together to find out what the right one is. And that's why we need a party to do that. But it is about people talking to each other. I mean, this is, it is quite simple stuff. It is just about people sitting around a table discussing a subject and looking at what the pros and cons are and figuring out what the ways and where the challenges are, where we're going to have to do some more work, where it's quite simple and taking it forward. And the poor planning authorities, I really feel sorry for in all of this, were given this to do some years ago. And this is not on land, this is on water. And what goes on water is, in a planning terms, is very difficult, very different to what goes on land. So some planning authorities have resource and expertise that goes back, but that's going away as time goes on because people retire. So this is not that none of the bodies are doing their job badly, if I could put it that way, but they would do it a lot better if they all talked to each other and communicated and did it round the same table.
So you spoke there about the resources and the level of expertise. So is that due to people, office holders, and being a lack of them, do you see that being any other issues?
The answer to your question is yes and no, and I'm not being difficult. It is, because as time has gone on, those people that specialised in offshore fish farming, for example, retire. They don't necessarily get replaced, because this isn't something that you do often within a council's planning department, for example. So if you're looking to recruit somebody into it, you'll probably recruit somebody into it with a more general knowledge of planning, rather than somebody to do this who might sit at their desk for a year before something would come onto their expertise. So it's a mixture of not doing it often enough, so you don't build up your level of expertise, to a lot of the experts, and there are still some about retiring and people not coming in. And so I've tried very hard in my report to say that I'm not criticising the planning officials. This is not their fault. This is just to do with the way this system works. And that's why it needs kind of taken out. And as the ex-chief executive of SEPA said to me when we interviewed him, these applications are very important because they're generally to do with tens of millions of pounds of investment. To let some junior member of staff deal with them in a non-cohesive way just doesn't seem sensible. So we need to lift them. We need to make sure that the more experienced and knowledgeable people within the organisation do that. So they are just very different, and there's not many of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Do you think there's potentially a reluctance for some of the big companies to invest because of the uncertainty over this, because we've heard there is a lack of resources, not just in planning, but a lack of resources and technical expertise when it comes to our marine environment. We saw that with the Clyde cod boxes and whatever. Is that a big constraint, and does it need to be addressed, given the importance of salmon farming to our economy? Should the government step up to the mark and provide some of that funding to resource that whole process a little bit more?
Well, it would do, because my recommendations say if we move to a system similar to Norway, where there's you basically buy a licence for 25 years and you pay a lot of money up front to do that, a portion of that money would go back into resourcing the process of doing that. And that is one of the challenges we have at the moment, that we need to pay for that. And the industry is quite happy to pay for that. But direct answer to your question, if this went on for some time and didn't get any better, then the two Norwegian and the one Faroese big international businesses that went to do would start, would start to look at how they do these things, because they're investing a lot of money. I think recently the Faroese one want to invest 700 million, I think it is, in the Scottish aquaculture industry over the coming years. So they're not running away, so I'm not saying that at all. They want to build the industry here, but we need to construct it in a better way. We're all parties, and it goes back to the point people are making, a community. So it's not just about the industry. So the industry, the community, and the regulators, and indeed the government, all have a say in what this goes on and what is becoming a much more complicated area. And, of course, what the group we haven't talked about are the customers who buy the salmon and the mussels and all that at the end, who themselves are imposing a lot more environmental restraints on what they want from their customer to produce. So the fish farm producers have already got long lists of audits, etc., they have to go through. But I think there's a way out of it, and I think it's quite a straightforward way out of it. And the industry's up for more investment. They want to grow the industry. At the moment, it's complicated and frustrating, and that's what we need to take away. And as you eloquently put it at the beginning, we need to restore the trust between all parties. They don't have to like each other, but we just have to restore the trust between all parties to make sure that as they develop and look at each of the applications that come in, consolidate, perhaps shut down some of the existing farms that perhaps weren't in the best place that they could have been in the first place, that it's done collegiately between us all.
Okay. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Convener. The aquaculture industry, as you have just touched on, has a target to double production by 2030 through expansion of open-net salmon farming. But I've been talking to concerned environmental NGOs and communities that stress that there's no evidence, either from Scotland or anywhere else, that open-net farming is or can be environmentally sustainable. On the contrary, we know that effluent from open-cage farms is discharged and dumped untreated into the sea. Toxic chemicals are used to kill sea lice, and that's also discharged into our marine environment. Tens of thousands of wild wrasse fish are taken from the wild to clean the sea lice off the salmon, and then the wrasse are killed, and to say nothing of the emissions from importing salmon feed from across the world or the impact on wild salmon populations here due to sea lice escapees and disease. And I just wanted to ask you if you recognise that these environmental impacts of the industry are not currently sustainable in the environmental sense of the word, as opposed to it often being used, sustainable being often used in economic sustainability. And have you seen any evidence to suggest that open net farms could reduce pollution, sea lice and fish escapees to close to zero?
I go back to what I said earlier. I think a lot of the science is based on how salmon farming was, not how it's going to be and how it is now. And I think that's what we need to build up as a scientific base that looks at where the industry is going, which is very sophisticated, very technical. A lot of it's done on land, and only a small part eventually will be done offshore. And I think when we've done that, and I'm not a scientist, so I can't, we will find that a lot of the issues that have been raised may not totally go away, but they may well be in the category of being manageable and being the way we look forward. So I don't think this is an insoluble problem, if I could put it that way. And I don't think putting it all on land is a really sensible way to go at all. Because if you look at the parts of the world that are looking at it, they have dreadful problems with disease. Their carbon footprint is astronomic. And if we're in all honesty, the reason that Scottish salmon does well and has a premium is because part of its life is in Scottish waters. If you put it in a big concrete tank and grew them there, there would be no advantage in Scottish salmon over somewhere bred around the M25. So we've got to be careful. That might be the end of the Scottish salmon industry. So I'm less worried, perhaps, than you are about where we are in all of this, because looking at where the industry wants to go technically, over the next year and over the coming decade, in terms of the way it controls pollution and the way it controls that, much more on land within very sophisticated, what are basically production units to produce salmon up to a certain size to go offshore, then I think a lot of what you were talking about will never be totally eradicated, but I think will become to work where it's environmentally manageable.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. You've already alluded to how sophisticated and technical modern-day salmon farming already is, and the key recommendation about a new single consenting process. I wonder if you could give examples of what we can take from the Norwegian one-stop-shop approach, example of what they do that we don't at the moment. Yeah. And also, if you could expand on how you would see the new process working in practice and who should take overall responsibility.
So the Norwegian one-stop-shop is quite interesting because it's not really a one-stop-shop. What it is that there's a one-person shop who sort of takes the application in and then goes and speaks to all the other people that he needs to do to make it proper. So from a developer's point of view, it's great, you pass it on to one person and then they go and do it. But they then go and bring in all the other parts of the Norwegian government and regulatory system that they need to do that. And so that means you get it back in a safe form. In my report, what I say is that the single consenting process needs managed. At the moment, I suppose the place you would logically put it is in a different part of Marine Scotland, which would have the task of taking applications as they come in, then gathering round the local planners, regulators that they need to do that, and taking through each one as it comes to be. So it's much more of a managed process. There's one person in charge of it. That doesn't stop all the other parties putting in what they need to do. So it would be, in my view, slightly better than the Norwegian process, in that it doesn't just disappear into a system somewhere. It's a very much managed process of all the parties working together. And I know that's exactly what both the regulators and the industry want to do, is to sit around the same table to look at what they do. So the single consenting document comes from a process of all the people involved, in, including the community, sitting around the table to say, here's what we're going to do. And that's really important for two points of view. When you get something consented, it's really important that you understand what has been consented and what then you can change and what you can't change without going back through the loop again. So that's why this document is not just about the application and getting it through. It's about, it says to the developer, the community and all the regulators, here's what we've agreed to do. And as technology advances, as the science advances, that allows those involved in that to move forward without having to come back the loop. But here are the things that if you want to change, you have to come back and ask us to do. So it gives much more certainty and much more clarity, not just to the developer, but to the planning authority, to the regulator, etc., what they've agreed to do. So in answer to specifically your question, at the moment I see somebody, a new part of Marine Scotland, taking on that role. And you need to put in quite strange people into that. And I'm being slightly flippant. They need to be an interesting mix of people that understand the aquaculture industry. So going back to the point that Karen made, not people that just do this on an odd day. Some people that really understand the aquaculture industry. Some people that but also have this wonderful thing about understanding rural communities. Because what rural communities worry about more than anything is somebody 250 miles away is making a decision for me, and I don't want to do that. So whoever is this person that manages the process has to be clever. They have to understand rural communities, and it's their job to make sure all part of that works. And the clear message coming back from everybody as we put in, and the single consenting process they all agree with, so I've got no disagreement on that, was whoever manages this has to be an expert in communities and in the aquaculture industry at the same time. And there's not many of them about, but there are some. So I'm quite content that those people exist out there. And then they take all the people around the table and take it to that. So it's very similar to the Norwegian one, but in my opinion, I think it would be slightly better.
Thank you. I would just say it's not rural communities, but island communities too.
Indeed. Indeed.
Jim Fairley.
It was very quick, so. Yeah. Just on the point you made about the bringing everybody together in a one-stop shop, do you see that as potentially, you said that one side of the argument was more organised than the other at the start of your introduction. Would you see that as potentially stifling the growth of the industry in Scotland if one side got themselves more organised through that one-stop shop?
No, because I think...
Sorry to use that phrase that you challenged. It's not a one-stop shop. Is that a potential?
No, I don't think so. I think because part of the role of the person sitting in the middle of this, the ringmaster, shall we call them, who does all this, is to make sure that it's the right voice for the community. So you go into the community. As the convener knows, all my life at the moment is spent with finding out what communities think. And it's quite challenging. But there are ways of doing it where you go into communities and find out what the proper voice in a subject is. And I don't think we do that well enough at the moment within this area. So I think there'll be a lot of community engagement, a lot of community consultation at the outset to find out what the correct voice, if that's the way of putting it, is. So I don't think it's just whoever turns up making the loudest noise. It's about what the benefits will be, what the impact will be in the community, and having that clearly explained. As to be fair, wind farm operators do now probably a lot better than they did, what, 10 years ago and 15 years ago when they come in to consult with the community. So very much in similar vein to that. Mm. So I think this is just about good management, and that's why it's so critical that the person who manages each of these applications understands communities.
Okay, thank you.
Jenny Minto.
Convener, and thank you, Professor Griggs, for coming along. I've been listening very closely to what you've been saying. I live on an island. I represent Argyll and Bute, so I am struck by the differing views from across the community, and I think you're absolutely right when you say you need to have the person that's there that can listen to both sides and, as you said and as the convener said, restore the trust. We've taken evidence about basically what happens in our seas across the last year, and you made the point as well that water is different from the land, and a lot of my constituents on both sides of the industry and community perspective, ENGOs, talk about that as well. One question that I've been trying to understand is how the flows of the water impact what the fish farms, how they're impacting, and also the cumulative effect of this, and then also how, as you've pointed out, the different, if you've got different planning authorities, how they're linking together. So I just wonder if you could maybe expand a bit on that.
I guess the point you raise is an interesting one from a number of aspects. And we don't gather together, as I've tried to say, the science, all the science is out there. And my goodness, there's more papers being written on this than probably anything else. I've got books on it. So, mm-hmm. But there's nobody gathering it together to give an opinion on your point that if you look at this across the whole of Scotland or across all the islands or across that there are... Because the debate about how much is local and about how much is national.
Yeah.
And we don't know at the moment, to be perfectly honest. If I take the views of the wild salmon body, for example, you could go in various different directions. But all we know, really, generally, is it's fish farming is one of 11 things that could have impacted on wild salmon. And probably, on a bad day, probably only up to a level of about 10%. So we need to understand what the other 11 things are doing, that's all to do with that. So I think this comes back to having somebody or thing that takes all the science, all the evidence that's there, and giving advice, because I don't understand all the flows that you're talking about either. I'm not a scientist, that's not my job. But somebody needs to. And then, as happens, there are parts of around the West Coast where there are particular flows that are particular to that part of that coastline, which you won't see anywhere else. Mm-hmm. And therefore, should you treat those differently to other parts? And how it is. So I think this is still a lot. I think this, the science bit in this is critical to make sure we better understand. Because each coastal community quite rightly goes away and does their own bit of work and they come up with it. But every time they come up with that, there'll be three others that come in and show something slightly mm-hmm. different. So we need a body that brings all that scientific data together mm-hmm. to understand. Because how water flows is really interesting. And from another part of my life some years ago, when this wonderful news that we were going to do everything by wave energy came to us, that's fine, but it depends on what the wave is. Mm-hmm. It still needs a lot of science mm-hmm. around it.
And if I may as well, on the other point that you raised as well about... the technology and how that's changing, how that can be made more obvious and more accessible, perhaps.
It is, and I mean, I think it's quite interesting. We visited the one of the new plants up in Oban, and I think they're going to do a very clever thing and a positive thing, which is turn it into a visitor centre, so that locals and visitors can go and visit it to see how all this works. And it's quite interesting, and I hear what's said about coastal communities, but I spend a lot of time, as you would, in doing this, on people in rib boats driving out into the ocean, etc. And what the people in the rib boats do is also, when they're not driving people like me about the ocean, is drive a lot of tourists about.
That's right.
And they would have a different view. They say fish farming is very positive, that all of the tourists they get on them, in general, there'll always be others, really are interested in what goes on and how it's done. So I think making it much more visible and much more transparent so that people can go and see what happens is what the industry should do more. And it's one of the, I think one of the comments I make in the report is, I don't think the industry's done a great job over the years of actually selling itself or indeed how it does things to the wider community.
I think that's a very important point, clear point that you've made. I think we've seen that with the way that wind farms have operated, and also in my constituency, the whisky distilleries as well, and the sharing of their technology and the sharing as to how things have changed. I think that's helpful. Should I just move on to the other fish types as well while I'm here? Is that
yeah,
okay?
Briefly, please.
Briefly.
Thank you.
I'm just interested as well, you touched on the fact that we were just talking about finfish, but there's also then connections with shellfish and seaweed as well. So any thoughts that you have on
industries? The reason I think they're different is because I think they're different. I think finfish is now a very sophisticated, heavily invested international business. I think our shellfish sector is growing, interesting enough, starting to grow a bit more because a lot of the bigger companies in Orkney are buying shell farms on the islands, etc., to give them some scale. The challenge in the shellfish sector is there isn't the margin that there is in salmon farming to give you the opportunity to invest in some of the sophisticated technology to take it forward. And so I think there are issues, but I don't think the great issues with shellfish. I think it could expand. But if you look at where it's gone from and compare it to finfish over the last 10 or 15 years, you don't see the same technological growth in how shellfish is done then perhaps. I'm not saying it hasn't changed, but not to the same degree. But I think until they get to the same point where they can charge a price point that's similar to the can in the finfish sector, they won't make the margin to make that. And that's just a commercial fact of life, I think. Seaweed I find fascinating, because I do think it is like they're still Klondiking for gold out there. And not just on how you do it, but on all the end uses are. And we have to remember that the scale we're talking with seaweed is huge. Mm. And I think I put in my report, now, if I misremember my number, please, I plead apology, to get 1,000 tonnes of seaweed, wet seaweed, farmed, you need a farm that's 7 kilometres by 5 kilometres. Now, that's a huge bit of ocean. And that's because you farm seaweed flat. It doesn't go down. It's entwined to bits of horizontal rope. So just the way it's structured makes it a need to take up. So my issue around seaweed is I don't think there'll be any constraints other than sea hazards. And I know it's an issue that a number of people have raised already about, if you're going to have something that's 7 kilometres by 5 kilometres sitting out near one of the islands, where do the fishermen go? Mm-hmm. How do they get around it? So I think that's more of a practical issue. But if you speak to all the people in the seaweed industry, they want it to grow, but they're not talking about astronomic numbers yet until they've figured out what it is and what they're doing. And I just think there's a long way to go in the seaweed sector before any of us around this table can decide what it would look like and what we'd want to do in terms of consenting to help them on the way. I will always remember my trip though to the seaweed farm because it was in a force-rate gale out in the middle of the Atlantic, so it was quite choppy.
Okay, well, thank you.
We might be able to look forward to something of that order in September. let's hope it doesn't get delayed any further into the autumn. Rachel Hamilton.
I just want to ask you about, in terms of the new regulatory framework, how it might improve the reduction in sea lice infestations, improve the numbers that are dying, maintaining the genetic integrity of wild salmon. I wanted to get your thoughts on how you thought that the Scottish Government had responded to the recommendations of the REC committee in session 5, and how will these welfare issues improve with a single consenting process for new applications as suggested in your review?
Okay, and I think it's the bit before the single consenting process that's the key in my recommendations, which is the creation of a framework. Lawyers, when they go to court, know what they can and cannot do, because it's all tied up in case law. It's been, and when we drive our cars, we have a framework which we drive our cars in with the rules and regulations. And that's put in place before I even get to wanting to go and pass my driving test. What we don't have currently is a framework of how we operate fish farming or aquaculture in Scotland. So that's why I think you need the framework before you need the consenting process. And within that framework, we would set targets over a 10-year period of not just the volume of fish we could do, because you would have to put some environmental constraint track that, but also to do with sea lice, and I list in my report a whole host of other things you put in that constraint. Now, that's government's job. It's not the regulator's job, that's government's job, because that's policy. That says we want to have a fish farming industry, but we understand that it does have challenges, and here are the constraints that we're going to put around that. So one of the most important things before you get... And then that makes it much easier for the single consenting process, because what it then has is when an application comes in, it looks at the framework and says, does it comply with the framework? Does it not comply with the framework? And if it doesn't comply with the framework, they've got a lot of work to do. And that's why I was quite clear in my report to say this is a 3-stage process. We need the framework before you get to the consenting process. If you just put in the consenting process without the framework, we'll still be wandering around looking at millions of bits of science, because we're all arguing about the bits of science. The framework decides what's the good science and what's the bad science. So around sea lice and all that stuff puts it in there. I think the way the industry is going anyway, technically, will reduce a lot of the stuff that's been talked about this morning, because where all the stuff, using the technical term, goes on at the moment is in seawater. If you can cut down the amount of time the salmon has to be in the seawater, then that will greatly reduce it. And as part of that framework, and the industry are up for this as well, we should be setting targets around how long salmon should spend at sea. Currently, it's fairly open-ended. It can be 2 to 3 years. The industry would like to get it down to 1 year. That will take some time and take a bit more sophistication. But they're getting there, and they're getting there quite rapidly. And that, I think, will address, Rachel, some of the points that you're making. So it will reduce sea lice, it will reduce the amount of chemicals we have to put into the water, etc. Will it be perfect? I don't know is the answer. We'd need to follow the science. But I think the way the industry is going technically will reduce a lot of what is currently seen. And this, I come back to the point about, as when we're looking at the fin fish sector, forget the other two for a minute, we must stop looking behind us. We must look ahead, because the industry is developing technically, it's developing the way it does. That's where we have to be making our decisions on, not what happened 15, 20 years ago, or even 5 years ago, but about where it's going. And I think if we do that, then we'll start to get a different perspective. That still won't stop some people not wanting it. Well, that's a different view. That's got nothing to do with me. But I do think if you look forward now, the risks that have been identified over the last years will become less because of the way we do it. In terms of the bit of work that government did, I can't comment on that. That was done. That's the government's choice to do. I was asked to do my piece of work, and I've done that.
Can I just ask a quick question on the framework itself? I'm on the understanding that the framework is going to take quite a considerable amount of time to get to the stage where it is produced. So, meantime, your observations of some of the issues within the industry that I've just spoken about, do you think that there should be priorities or technology should be in place before the framework?
Yeah, I think it's a very good question. I think the answer is that I would hope, I would be pushing hard around the framework, if I'm honest, in terms of time, because I think it's very, very important to get that in place. But I would hope, if we're agreed that there's going to be a framework, which we all seem to have agreed on that, that as we start to get applications in and re-evaluate them now, we start to look at what the framework might look like in the future. So in many ways, doing one or two applications might help us to form a better framework because we're taking some of those decisions early on, but we'll still have to go and address things like the scientific evidence, etc., and bringing that together. So I have some sympathy with your point of view that says this could be done, this should be done quicker. But I do hope that as the applications come in, given now that we have a roadway and a direction of travel, that what will go on out there will help that direction of travel perhaps get to where it wants to a bit quicker.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Mercedes for a quick supplementary on this and then to move on to the next section. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Professor Griggs. It's a slight tangent, but as we were talking about welfare issues and sea lice, I thought it might be a good moment to bring up the RAS fisheries. So as I understand it, the remit of the review was, or of the report, was to review the operation of the regulatory framework for aquaculture from the perspective of other users of the shared marine environment, including wild fisheries. So the RAS fishery is a wild fishery. It's entirely economically interdependent with aquaculture. And so I wondered if you could just talk us through your rationale for not considering it as part of your report.
Well, I did consider it as part of my report. No, we did speak to them. And I suppose this comes back to the point that Rachel's just made, is that when you come to design the framework, you've got to put all of that into the pot to decide what you can do. So this is not... there's a list of things that you would start to consider, and the impact on wild fish and RAS and everything would go in there. So while I haven't specifically mentioned it in my report, and you may well be right, it's not that I didn't think it was unimportant. It's just as we start to get all these experts around the table to look at what all the issues are, I'm sure that's one of the issues that will come forward that we want to put in it. So I'm not disregarding it, if I could put it that way.
That's reassuring. And so do you think it would be appropriate that the wild RAS fishery would... that we would introduce stock assessments or limits on catches, given that we're getting reports of extreme declines in the RAS populations?
I have no idea the answer to that question. I'm not... I could do with a good scientist sitting beside me, perhaps, to answer that. But I don't know. I think... all of these things are things, and that's part of the challenge, that we need to go away and look at not just where we need to cohese the science, but where there's gaps in the science. And if there's gaps in the science, then we need to commission people to go away and do that scientific work to fill in the holes.
I suppose the point I'm angling at, excuse the pun, is that we have fisheries management plans required for other species, so would it not make sense to bring in something similar for RAS, as has been adopted elsewhere in the UK?
Pass.
OK, no problem. Thank you.
OK. Have you covered your second question?
That was under three. And then four, or...?
Yes, if you could move on to your next question.
OK, sorry. Okay. I'll keep it brief. So we've got the precautionary principle enshrined in Scottish law through the UK Withdrawal Act. And I was wondering how relevant would you say this principle is to decision-making about environmental harm caused by salmon farming?
The precautionary principle is a fascinating subject. We could spend all day discussing the precautionary principle. And the precautionary principle operates well where somebody who's deciding on what's a precaution understands what it is they're talking about in the particular sector and the specific technology they're talking about. The precautionary principle, sadly, where you don't know anything about it, leads you generally to take no risk at all, because that's what you do. And that's why what has been called the adaptive principle, which is somewhere in the middle of this, has become, I think... So my view is, if the precautionary principle is put in place by people that understand what it is they're doing, and therefore make that decision on knowledge, understanding, science, etc., 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 then it's fine. The challenge we have with the precautionary principle, and speaking to a lot of the people that I did doing this, is that if you don't know anything about it, it tends to put to the "I will take no risk at all" end of the spectrum. And that's where it shouldn't be. Because the precautionary principle is supposed to make you make good decisions on good knowledge. And if you don't have the good knowledge, it's very difficult to make the good decisions. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on theme four, otherwise I can ask my question on theme five.
I'm going to carry on. We're very short of time. Karen.
Thank you, convener. You spoke a little bit about seaweed earlier, and this is something I find absolutely fascinating and quite exciting, actually. And I know you probably know this, but just you know, for the case of being on record and for MD watching, it can be used for human consumption, food consumption, animal feed, biofuel, fertiliser, cosmetics, pharmaceuticals, biomaterials in terms of packaging, and actually mitigating climate change in the form of carbon sequestration. I have a bit of an interest in this and have been looking into it because one of the local authorities in my constituency actually commissioned a consultancy company to see if this could be a financially viable business, and it was recommended that it absolutely is for commercial cultivation. But when you were speaking earlier there about, you know, there could be a clash of interests, as with, you know, a lot of, we're looking at the seascape at the moment and how these things are, but do you think there's a space for this in terms of diversification into other areas, and is there anything that a potential seaweed sector could learn from finfish and regulations in that regard?
Yeah, I guess, right, let me try and answer your question sensibly. I think what you said at the beginning is the opportunity, but also the challenge. Mm. Seaweed can be used in a whole host of things. So it's trying to find out what your target market is at the beginning has always been a challenge. So I guess if seaweed is to develop, it needs to do what Finfish did, which is focus down on what is my advantage by where I am and what I can sell. And once they figure that out, then they can do that. I do think the spatial challenges with seaweed are quite significant. And until we technologically come up with a different way of creating seaweed, which is basically, I mean, basically sticking a little bit of seaweed in a rope and putting it around it and allow it to grow. And I mean, it all sounds quite simple, but that's exactly what it is. Then we'll still have that spatial issue. The challenge is as well to get 1,000 tonnes of wet seaweed that then turns into it. By the time it's dried, you're reducing your quantities. I think it is, I'm like you, I'm very positive about seaweed, but I think it still has a journey to go both technologically and figuring out what the best markets are and the best type of seaweed then it can grow in Scottish waters, because it is to do with, as was mentioned earlier, to do with water flow and everything else as well. So I think there's a long journey for seaweed still to go. But you're quite right. The thing that's pulling them on and on is this plethora, literally plethora, of possible end uses for it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just going to touch on this very briefly, but spatial planning, you referred just to seaweed, but we've got seaweed, we've got the inshore fisheries with mobile gear, static gear, we've got renewables, cockle fishery, mussel fishery. Is one of the starting points not to look at the whole spatial planning issue and the pressures that all these different sectors could bring to our inshore marine environment?
They are. I mean, and indeed, as I went round, I think I mentioned the report, is, you know, each council is now supposed to produce a marine plan. I don't think many have, because it's quite challenging. It's not without its issues. Now, I think Orkney and Shetland have, but I think a lot of the others that have, where aquaculture and marine issues are very important to them, have still got to do that. So I think what I would say is that the vehicle is already there to do it if they want to do it. But again, it comes back to resource. It comes back to who you get to do it, because it's not easy. But I think the vehicle's already there. How you then mix that in with what they're doing on land in terms of spatial planning is not for me to say, but I agree with you entirely. And if we go back to what I was talking about earlier about wave power, I mean, once you put that in the middle of it as well, then it becomes much more complicated. You could end up just having our waters around our coast totally unapproachable by anybody if you wanted to get on with it. So I do think so, but I think pushing the local authorities and marine planning has got to be something that we integrate, but they've already got the task to do. It was given to them some time ago.
Thank you. You know, we've touched on resources a lot in the conversation. The resources automatically move on to finance. So Alistair Allen's got some questions on finance.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose really a general one firstly, and that is if you're able to offer any outline, any view about firstly additional potential costs or additional benefits indeed around the new process, particularly in terms of your recommendations and the consenting process, and where the balance you feel of those costs and benefits might lie with the various parties involved.
Okay, so I think it's been quite interesting. I mean, there's no doubt, and I made it quite clear in this, that what I'm recommending will cost money. You know, this is not going to be a cost-neutral exercise. It's not. And all the parties have agreed that we need to do this, and we need to do it that way. And the way we need to do it is that you pay, or the industry pays, in its licence fee, however long we give that, from whether we move to a Norwegian model where you pay a lot of money for 25 years, or where we adapt what it is we want to do, is there needs to be a section of that allocated to resources to do this. And that's not just for the person, Marine Scotland, who's going to manage all this, but that's back in each local authority, and it's quite interesting. In the conversation we had with COSLA around the costings around this, COSLA see this very much quite uniquely as something that each local authority should decide how to do on its own. So there shouldn't be a national policy for this, if I can put it that way, because some will want to keep it in-house, some may want to contract it out, some may want to give it back to the government to do, that we should do it that way. But to get back to your point, there needs to be, and that's why we need now to start to look at how much all the proposals, assuming they all go ahead, are going to cost. That then forms part of what we're going to charge the developer to develop the project. We then have to add in a portion of that, quite a large chunk, about what goes back in community benefit, whatever we call community benefit, into that. So, and everybody is up for that. I mean, if you look at the amounts of money that the companies that we are talking about in Finnfish already have to pay for licences in Norway and elsewhere, we're talking about considerable sums of money. How should we collect that? Now, you can do it two ways, in my opinion. Either government collects it all and then and then puts it out again, or you get the Crown Estate to do it. The Crown Estate already leases some of the land. They charge it. They've already got a process in place to do it. I'm having dinner with the Crown Estate tonight, and I'm sure they will be saying that's not what they should be doing. but my own view is why create something new if it already exists? But we need a central body that brings all the money in. And interestingly enough, the local authorities, as we go around, we talked about, going back to your point at the beginning about trust, are trusting that whatever service we put in will bring the resource back to them of what they're doing. So they're not saying, no, 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 it all has to come to us. They understand that to get A, you've got to do B. And B is about creating a sensible form of money that you charge the developer for the project, that allows to put in place the resource you need to make that work well for them and everybody else, and also then to give the community that benefit. And thirdly, which I just about forgot, which I shouldn't, to go back to the point that has been made myriad around this table today, to allow some funding to go back in and do some of the scientific research that we're going to have to do around some of this stuff as we go forward.
Perhaps related to that last point, you mentioned earlier on that there was a certain kind of circularity in the funding system that exists in Norway. Could you explain that a little bit more?
Oh, goodness me.
Very briefly.
The answer to the question, could we do that off-piste, please? Because it's quite complicated and will take a little bit of time for
that. That will be fine. You can write a letter to the
Yeah,
Government.
We'd absolutely appreciate your views on that. Finally, the final question, Ariane Burgess.
And actually, I'm just going to pick up, Professor Grace, you were talking about science just there. And your review says that those using science must ensure that they have the most current, effective and relevant scientific evidence to defend their arguments against any negative issues.
We don't have time to go back. Sorry, Ariane, I'm to interrupt. Could you just, we really need to get the final question answered and move on. Apologies.
Yeah, this is the final question that I need to get answered, Convener. I just wanted to understand, Professor Griggs, you know, there is concern in community groups and NGOs about the fact that there's a proposed central science evidence base and that will be run and managed by the industry and the Scottish Government. And I just, you know, how would you assure concerned stakeholders that your recommendations will ensure independence of the science used for decision making on aquaculture expansion and regulation?
And I guess I would do, I would say it would be the same independent science that we use for any other part of things that government do. The government's got what's at the Scottish Scientific Advisory Group, which covers all parts of science within the Scottish Government. And that looks very independent. So I would think, so while it's, how you manage it by the industry and Scottish Government doesn't mean to say that it's not independent. So I would see something like perhaps the Scottish Science Advisory Group, which is the thing that does and advises the government on science generally, being that independent body. So it's not about trying to preclude any science. It's about making sure that the science we look at is the best possible science that's available. And that's what the my understanding is, that something like the Scottish Science Advisory Group is there to do.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Very, very unfortunately, because I know we had a lot of supplementaries we weren't able to bring in there, that this is a topic that the committee is intending to carry into to next session. Indeed, we're hoping to ask the Cabinet Secretary questions on your review and also the establishment of short-term project board at our first meeting in September. So no doubt our paths will cross again in the future. But thank you very much for your time this morning, Professor Griggs. We now move on to our next item, which we'll be taking in private. So that concludes our business in public. Thank you.